Let's see how to approach an intramolecular aldol condensation. So over here on the left, we have a 2,5-hexanedione. And if we add sodium hydroxide and we heat things up, we would form this compound over here on the right. So we would actually form a ring. Let's go ahead and number our dione over here. It's symmetrical, so we could start from either side. So I could say this is carbon 1, carbon 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. So we have 2,5-hexanedione here. And if we add sodium hydroxide, we're going to deprotonate at the alpha carbon. So I need to find my alpha carbons here. So that's the carbon next to the carbonyl. So carbon 1 could be an alpha carbon. Carbon 3 could be an alpha carbon. And then over here, right, these would also be alpha carbons to this carbonyl. But since it's symmetrical, we don't need to worry about those. So we just need to focus in on the possible alpha carbons at 1 and 3. Let's first do this thinking about deprotonating at alpha carbon 1 here, at alpha carbon, which is carbon 1. So I put my alpha proton on here, and I think about hydroxide taking this alpha proton, right, leaving these electrons behind on this carbon. And so here I have the dione drawn in a different conformation. And let's go ahead and number this one. So this would be carbon 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. This is just going to help us when we're thinking about forming our product. And so if we're deprotonating at carbon 1, right, so these electrons in here would end up on carbon 1 to form a carb anion. So I'm showing those electrons in magenta on carbon 1, so that's a negative 1 formal charge on this carbon. And for this mechanism, I'm going to show the carb anion functioning as a nucleophile. So it's going to attack this carbonyl over here. We know this carbonyl has a partial negative oxygen, a partial positive carbon. So this carbon right here is electrophilic. So our nucleophile is going to attack our electrophile, right? So these electrons in here are going to attack here, pushing these electrons off onto our oxygen. So let's go ahead and show the result of that. We would actually form our ring here. So I'm going to draw our 5-membered ring. We would have our carbonyl right here, and we would form an alk oxide, and then we could think about protonating to form our aldol. So I'm just going to draw the aldol here, and then we would have a methyl group right here. So let's follow some of those electrons, right? So the electrons in magenta moved in here to form our bond. And then let's number our carbons too. So this would be carbon 1, carbon 2, right, 3, 4, 5, and 6 in terms of the numbering system that we used over here on the left. So it just helps us to follow those carbons along here. And so this would be our aldol. And then we know that this is our alpha carbon right here, so we could deprotonate that. So I'm going to go ahead and draw an alpha proton right here. And so we could think about hydroxide coming along, right, functioning as a base, right, and taking that proton. So the hydroxide takes this proton. These electrons move in here to form your double bond, and you have hydroxide as your leaving group. So when we draw the product, right, we have our ring. Right, we have our carbonyl right here, we would have a double bond now, and then we would have our methyl group like that, and so that's obviously our product. Let's follow those electrons. Right, we already had a carbon-carbon bond formed in here, but if we take the proton, right, these electrons in blue can move in here to form our double bond, and then we have our product. And so this would be the major product for this reaction. So that's showing deprotonation at the alpha carbon, which we labeled 1 right here. Let's show what would happen if we deprotonated the alpha carbon that we numbered 3. So we'll do that in the next area we have down here. All right, so the same conformation we're starting with before, right? So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. If we deprotonate at carbon 3 this time, then that's where we'd form our carb anion. So let me go ahead and show the lone pair of electrons on this carbon 3 right here. That gives that carbon a negative 1 formal charge. And so we could think about this being our nucleophile and attacking right here at this carbon. So that would push these electrons in here off onto the oxygen. So let's go ahead and draw the result of that. This time we would actually form a 3-membered ring. So let's go ahead and draw everything in, and then let's follow everything around here. So we have a methyl group right here, and then we would have an O, and that'd be our alk oxide, which we could protonate to form our aldol as our intermediate here. So let's once again number these carbons, even though this isn't how you would actually number it. It just helps us to follow everything along here. So let me go ahead and number in red. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and this is where carbon 6, again, using these numbering system over here on the left, just to make it a little bit easier for us. So the electrons in magenta, right, are the ones that form this bond between carbon 3 and carbon 5 like that. And once again, we know that carbon 3 is an alpha carbon, so there's an alpha proton on here, and so we could think about hydroxide coming along and functioning as a base, right? So hydroxide is going to take this proton, leave these electrons behind, and then we have hydroxide as a leaving group, and so another possible product would be this three-membered ring right here, and then we would have a methyl group. And then we would also have our ketone over here like that. And so we had already formed a carbon-carbon bond with the electrons in magenta. And then if we take this proton, right, these electrons in blue, right, could move in here to form our double bond. And so it turns out that this small ring here, right, it's possible to form this, but it's not isolated in large yield in this reaction because there's too much angle strain for this three-membered ring, and so this isn't really isolated as your product. Your product is this one. There's less angle strain to form this five-membered ring, but it is possible to get a three-membered ring in this. So, but the five-membered ring is going to be your major product here. So let's do one more intramolecular aldol condensation, all right? So very similar to the last one, actually. So it looks a little bit more complicated, but we can analyze it the same way. So if we're looking for our alpha carbons, right, we know those are the ones next to our carbonyls. Let's go ahead and number this compound. This would be carbon 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. And so for our alpha carbons, right, we know carbon 1 would be an alpha carbon, we know carbon 3 would be an alpha carbon 4, and then carbon 6, right? So those are our possibilities. So carbons 3 and 4, if you think about these being alpha carbons, these would give us a ring with a little bit too much angle strain, so we can kind of rule those out. And so now it's down to thinking about carbon 1 or carbon 6. And for that, we need to look at the base, right? So we're using potassium hydroxide here. So we're using a non-sterically hindered base, and it isn't very strong. And so it's going to favor the formation of the thermodynamic enolate, which is the more stable one because it's more substituted. So we talked about this in an earlier video. And so if you look at an alpha, if you look at deprotonation at alpha carbon, which we have labeled 1 here, that would give you the kinetic enolate, which is formed the fastest but is not the most stable. If you deprotonate at the alpha carbon that's 6, that would give you the thermodynamic enolate. So it's more substituted than the kinetic enolate, so it's more stable. So if you think about the fact that on this alpha carbon, right, there are two alpha protons right here, and if your base takes one of these alpha protons, right, then these electrons would move into here, push these electrons off onto your oxygen. So let's do the same thing down here, where we have a different conformation, so very similar to how we did the last one. So one of these acidic protons right here on our alpha carbon, I'll go ahead and draw it in right here. So we have our hydroxide come along and function as a base, right? So hydroxide anion, right? So negative 1 charge is going to take this proton, right? Leaving these electrons into here, pushing these electrons off onto the oxygen. So I'm going to draw the oxyanion this time, right? So this is going to be in equilibrium. So let's go ahead and show, first I'll show what we would get, and then we'll follow some electrons around, right? So I have my carbonyl here. And then we're going to form our oxyanion. So I'm going to go ahead and draw negative 1 formal charge on this oxygen. There's now a double bond right here. And then we'll go ahead and draw on the rest of our carbons. So this is the thermodynamic enolate. Right? So if you look at this double bond, this is going to be the most stable enolate that forms because of the substitution of this double bond here. So following those electrons, let's go ahead and make those electrons in here blue. So these electrons in here, right, would move in here like that. And then you could think about your electrons, your pi electrons in here moving off onto your oxygen to form your oxyanion like that. And so once again, this is the thermodynamic enolate because this reaction is under thermodynamic control because of our choice of base. Next, we're going to show our oxyanion functioning as a nucleophile. So once again, our carbonyl is polarized, right? Partial negative, partial positive. All right, so we could think about these electrons, right, in red moving into here. And then we could think about these electrons, pretend these are our pi electrons in here, attacking at our carbonyl, right, pushing these electrons off onto our oxygen. So let's go ahead and draw, right, the result of our nucleophilic attack right here. Right, so we would form our ring. It'd be a five-membered ring. So let's go ahead and draw our five-membered ring here. We would form a carbonyl, right? And then let's see, at this carbon, we would have this group coming off here, right? And then we would form an alkoxide, which we could protonate to form our aldol. And then we have a methyl group right here. So let's follow those electrons. So a lot happened here. So if the oxyanion acts as your nucleophile, right, so these electrons in here, which I'm saying are your pi electrons, right, are going to form this bond right here. So very similar to how we did it in the previous video, right, except we're using an oxyanion this time as our nucleophile. These electrons in here move in to reform your carbonyl. Right, and if we're thinking about carbons, right, so this carbon right here is this carbon. And let's identify some other carbons. So this carbon right here is this carbon. And then this carbon is this carbon, just so it's getting a little bit confusing in terms of what we have. So if we go back to our alpha carbon here, right? So there's an acidic proton on that alpha carbon. So I could go ahead and draw that in, right? And then our base could come along. So hydroxide could come along and take that acidic proton. So let's go ahead and show that. So negative one formal charge takes this proton. Right, these electrons move in here and you lose hydroxide, and then you have your products. Let's go ahead and draw in our products. So we have a five-membered ring, right? We have a ketone here, we have a double bond here, and then we retain the stereochemistry of this group that's coming off, and then we have a methyl group. So we had already formed a carbon-carbon bond in here, right? And then let's go ahead and make these electrons in here. Let's make them magenta, right? So these electrons in here are going to move in to form your pi bond to give you your product. So the product is called cisjasmone, and it's found in jasmine flowers, and so it gives it its scent. So this is a pretty cool reaction, an intramolecular aldol condensation, which gives you a product that's used in the perfume industry in a pretty good yield.